Welcome, everyone. I'm going to tell you what not to do is have a cookie before you introduce a show. Elyse, thanks for ruining that for me, too. No, we're super excited and welcome, everyone, to the SVK Network. We have a, I don't even know why I say it's a great show. This is a phenomenal show that's coming up right now. We're calling it the New Butcher Show. We'll have to come up with a name and talk. We'll have to come up with a name, but we have Elyse on here. And Elyse, I think I'm going to need to call you the Protein Ninja, Cisco. Is that cool? Does that work?
It's very good.
You like that? Do you like that?
Yeah.
Anyways, you are, like, I thought I knew beef and protein and stuff, and I know nothing now. Thanks for trumping that. I absolutely don't know anything anymore. What was that? What'd you say?
Teach new things.
Exactly. I'm going to turn that music down. Let me turn this thing down. We don't need that hype. There we go. We're all good. All right. What are we doing today, Ninja?
Okay. So we're just going to break down this striploin that I've got right in front of us. And we're going to talk a little bit of meat science, not too geeky. I told my kids I was going to talk meat science, and they were like, don't go overboard, Mum. You can be quite a lot. Like, don't go crazy on the meat science. But we're just going to talk about some of the things that, as a butcher, I feel it's really important to know if you're going to get the best from the meat that you're buying. Like, as we know, meat is pretty expensive, and it's got even more expensive recently. So you've got to know how to get the best out of it, basically. So yeah, I'm going to do some cuts out of here. But like I say, we are going to talk a little bit of meat science. And I know we were chatting before about the price of meat, and I was just going to start with the shocker. But basically, the average price of a strip loin on Canadian restaurant menus in 2018 was $22.70. And as of last year, the average price of a strip loin on a menu is $54.75, which goes to show the changes that we have seen in the industry. We saw massive increases in the cost of beef when COVID hit, and they've really not dropped. So I think this is what we now have to expect, that it is more expensive. So you've got to know how to get the best out of it.
Well, at least before we get into that, I got to run this quick commercial because Restaurants Canada show's coming up, and I'm going to do a little plug for it. And then we're going to come back and watch you educate the most knowledge I've ever had at once about protein.
Okay.
Cool. Okay. Yeah. We're right back.
Been through a whole lot, but we overcome. Enemies in our face, but we ain't gonna run. Never drift off course, always stay on mission. Won't slow us down, cause we way too driven. Yet we put in these 10,000 hours. You won't stop us, cause we got the power. Whole world is watching, and I hope they ready. From here on out, we are legendary.
We ain't going nowhere. We'll be standing right here. Until the end of time. Till the end of time. We ain't going nowhere. We'll be
standing. Like, oh, it just cuts right off. All right. You rock our world right now.
Awesome. Okay, so striploin. So this muscle comes from the big, long muscle that runs down the back of an animal. So I don't have, I was trying to look in my house this morning to see if I had a cow that I could show you, and I don't. So I have a dinosaur, which is one of my child's. So no dinosaurs were harmed in the making of this show. But it's basically from the shoulder all the way into the back of the hip. It's this muscle that runs down the back of the spinal cord, like the back on the outside of the spine down here. And it's called the longimus dorsi muscle. Okay, so it goes all the way through the middle of the ribeye, and it goes all the way through the shoulder. It's the eye piece in the chuck eye roll, basically. So it's a very, very long muscle. Now, the way it works is the harder a muscle works, the more flavor that muscle will have, but the tighter the connective tissues in that muscle will be. So that means it's going to be tougher unless you do something to it where you cook it longer, you marinate it. Anything on the front end and the back end of the cow just works harder because of the fact that they have four legs and that's where they do all of their work. So anything in this centerpiece chills out a little bit and doesn't work as hard. So this muscle here has the benefit of working a little bit, but not working so much that it's not tender. So the definition of a steak is a muscle that can be cooked quickly and is tender, okay? So we're thinking ribeyes, we're thinking strip loins, we're thinking tenderloin, okay? So I'm gonna start cutting this. There are different, there's two techniques for how we say whether something, I'm just gonna grab this cloth, something is tender, okay? We have, there's two tests. There's a Bratzler shear force test and a slice shear force test. So basically, a steak is cooked and then it's the force taken to cut that steak once it's been cut. The higher the number means the more force it took to cut that steak, so the tougher it is, okay? So the most tender steak we have is a tenderloin, okay? And the reason being is it's a useless muscle. It sits on the inside of the rib cage and doesn't do anything. So it has the least flavor of any other steak, but it is the most tender.
Okay. Wait. Okay. Let me just clarify this because you're just changing this for me as well. Okay. So you're saying that the muscle that doesn't move has no flavor.
The least flavor.
The least flavor.
It doesn't have no flavor, but it has the least
flavor. The least. Now, does that mean it has more fat or less fat?
Less fat. So no sort of interfat generally, unless it, like, it will have some fat in there. The way fat's distributed around your body, it's just, it goes around your organs, it goes around the muscle groups, and it just pulls in different areas. Around the kidney, there's a big piece of fat, which is there to protect the kidney. So your body puts fat in places where it thinks it needs it, okay? Unless you've eaten too many cookies before the show, and then it puts it wherever it likes. But yeah, so a muscle needs to work to have flavor. You think about an ox, like a cow cheek. So cheeks are delicious. They are the most beefy flavor you're going to get, but they are incredibly tough. A cow chews, even when it's asleep, its mouth is always chewing. They
Serious?
Never, they're always chewing. They just chew.
A cow's mouth, when they sleep, their mouth is moving?
Yeah, they do. Their mouths, you can see them chewing. Like, they're just, I think they're drinking grass. I don't know. But yeah, so that muscle there is incredibly flavorful, but it needs a long time to cook to break that connective tissue. So a muscle like this is perfect because it doesn't work too hard, but it works enough to give it flavor, okay? So imagine this is the back of the cow here. This is the centerpiece, okay? Further forward here is where the ribeye comes from and then into the shoulder. And then further back here is where the it's not called the rump steak. That's the English name.
I was going to say it was a rump roast. Is that the where the rump roast?
Yeah. No, the sirloin.
Okay.
Actually, this end of the strip loin is the tissue end, which is it kind of dips out slightly, and that's where you have that other muscle group here. You can just see it. This muscle here is different than this one below. So this is actually that top little bit there is actually the back end of the strip of the sirloin.
No way.
Yeah. So the sirloin would be here.
Yeah.
The ribeye steaks would be here. So the ribeye has more marbling and it works harder because it's going towards that front shoulder, which is why it's a more flavorful steak than this one right here, the strip loin. So I'm going to take this first piece off. So
you're doing the test? Is that what you're testing right now?
No, the test actually, those two tests are done on a cooked steak.
A cooked one? Okay.
So the Bratzler shear force test and the slice shear force test are both done. They cook it, they cool it, and then it kind of goes into this fancy box, and then a knife just gets, like a special knife gets pushed through, and the force that that knife uses to go through is its measurement of tenderness. Hmm. So the more force required to go through, the tougher the steak. So it's like a balancing act. Like, you want a muscle to work, but you don't want it to work so much that it's then no longer a steak. So you think about a veal calf. So the reason that veal was so prized was because it was very young. So its muscles haven't developed very much. And then obviously years ago, the very bad practice of not allowing them to move around very much meant that their muscles just didn't develop, which has kept the meat incredibly tender. And that's kind of why they did it. And now we obviously know that that's a terrible thing to do and they don't do that anymore. You see more, it's called rose veal, where it's allowed... It's still quite young, but it's allowed to move around, stay with its mother for a longer period of time. down. And then, yeah, so that's a new product that we're seeing a lot in the UK. Not so much here, but it's called rose veal rather than true veal. So it's not pale. It kind of goes like a pinky blush color because the muscles are being used.
Yep.
It still has that. It's still very tender, but it has a bit more flavor. So, yeah. So, yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. Okay. So I'm just going to cut a steak here. So one of the things also I wanted to talk about was the fact that during COVID, we saw a lot of cows that were going to slaughter get bigger. Okay. And restaurants may have seen this, that the loins that we are using get bigger and bigger and bigger. Okay. And it's just how it works. And because the price of steak has gone up so much, we are faced now with a challenge. So if I want to cut an 8-ounce steak from this piece here, I can cut it no problem. And it will probably, this isn't too big, it will probably be about 3/4 inch in size, in thickness. So perfect. The problem is the bigger the loin, if you're trying to maintain an 8-ounce steak, the thinner the steak will be. So this year, more than ever, we're seeing kind of these new hybrid steaks. So it's kind of, it's called a, it's actually called a strip loin fillet. I think it's also, we refer to it as a Cali cut sometimes. It's
is that the baseball?
Baseball steak, yes. It's basically, I'll show you. It's one of the, it's a steak that's cut normally across the center like this. So that would be your normal steak right there. Yep. So very nice. Nice marbling in this steak there. That's good. So yeah, and basically they would take this tail section off here, which is this fat part.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then the steak simply gets cut in half. So you get, there's the baseball there. Strip loin fillet. So you still get the nice fat across the top, which obviously is essential because the fat is where all the flavor is. Don't ever cut that all off. That's bad, bad, bad. But yeah, that's what we're seeing a lot of this year, like to try and keep the plate price down, but still maintain that steak.
So at least I've seen a lot of people that would take that strip loin right now the way it is, and sit there for a half an hour and just chip away at that fat cap. Is that a no-no or just the way it is? There's enough, is that okay? Like, tell me more.
Sorry. There's an amount of fat that I think is acceptable. So fat does, obviously it gives flavor, but fat is really only good if it's nice kind of crispy fat. Nobody wants like wibbly, not very fat. Like, you don't want it to be too thick. Anything thicker than your little finger is probably too much, in my opinion, because you're not going to get that nice sear on the outside. It's a bit too much. It affects the texture. Like, you don't want so much. Like, this has got just a nice little fat cap across the top here. Perfect. You're not going to need to pull any fat. The only time you would need to pull some fat, I apologize if my dog barks now because the doorbell.
That's okay. That's why our shows are good.
Yeah, there's some fat here that dips into the back. So just in this part here, which is why it's quite hard to cut this all the way through. And even because once you start to get to, I'll just cut it into the back here and you can see what I'm talking about, is you can see how the fat starts to get more as we get into this top part here. And then this muscle here at the top is the one that I was talking about, which is the back of the sirloin. So it starts to go into a different muscle group. So this piece here is the bit that restaurants kind of need to be clever about how they cut this. So it's called a tissue end steak. So you need to kind of make sure that you don't have too much of this top piece.
It's
completely different muscle. So it needs a different cooking time, basically, because it is a different muscle group on the back there. So each muscle works differently in the body. So that one works a little bit harder because it's back hip. So yeah, that's why it kind of happens.
So let me just, I have so many questions. I'm just trying to keep it so we keep this under 2 hours. No. Is that, what's some of the common mistakes then people do when they get a strip loin like that? Can you just kind of hit on some of those points? Like, what do you see out there?
A tissue end strip loin, you mean?
Yeah, well, that, and we'll get into this, the other part of the strip loin, because I want to, what do they do with that wrong right there?
Well, you know, like you can get, like that one there is probably not too bad because the tissue piece isn't too big. But once you start getting where it's really big like this, like if you see that one in a butcher's shop or on a menu, it's probably not the best steak that they should be giving you. Like, an end-to-end cut obviously goes into that tissue end, and there's nothing you can't, you know, it's still a usable steak, but you're probably best to think of how you can make that into a satay skewer or do something else with it, marinate it in a certain way that's going to help break down those tissues in that other muscle group at the top. So like I said, you can either cook it for longer or do something to it, like marination. You know, we know that citrus starts to break down sour, you know, like sour things like buttermilk. You know, if you put chicken in buttermilk, it starts to break down those connective tissues. You need to do something to break those links in the connective. Like, think of bodybuilders. You know, they build their muscles up big, and that's because they're creating those tight muscle chains in the chains inside the muscle that makes them bigger and stronger. And that's what meat does. So the more that muscle has worked, the tighter those chains are, and the more marination or heat you need to apply to loosen them off. So yeah, different muscle groups. So you need to be doing something else with that. You know, all of this trim, apart from this kind of silvery piece across the back here, makes the best burgers. Like, you can make amazing burgers. Like, you can do so many things with it. There's really not very much waste on this whole loin. You are not losing very much at all off a full loin if you are smart and savvy about how you use those bits, basically.
Is that maybe, like, is that the piece of meat that some people would use, like, a tenderizer for, those hammers and stuff like that?
Totally. Yeah. Yeah. You, again, you are breaking down those connective tissues. So that action of hitting it, that's what you're doing. You are making,
is that like a no-no?
No, no.
Because you kind of cringed when I said the hammer thing. Yeah, it was, you know, a butcher.
I cringe because there are certain steaks that aren't really steaks, and they use those tenderizers to make it. I always feel like it's somebody else has chewed it for you before you chew it. It's like a pre-chewed steak, and I'm not for that. But if you're making, like, a schnitzel, then, yeah, pound that meat, get it nice and thin. You want it nice and thin and nice and tender. That's it. It has
That's perfect. Position,
yeah. But like most things, it gets misused a little bit. Like, it's used to create a steak from something that isn't really a steak.
Okay. You're still there.
Yeah, I'm not Yeah, you can pretty much tenderize anything. And obviously the science now, we've kind of seen that there are actually other muscles in the body of an animal that previously we would never have classed as a steak. And because of those tests, the Ratzler shear force test and the slice shear test, they know now that these other steaks are tender. So the petite tender, the flat iron, the bavette, you know, these other steaks. Yeah. Previously, we were like, no, that goes in stew, that goes in grind. And it's like, no, it's actually a really delicious steak. And we'll touch on that on the next butcher show.
Okay.
We could go on forever. But yeah, it's the world is expanding because in the beef world now, because we don't just say, oh, no, that's always been this. You now think, okay, well, how can we look at this different? You know, how can we take this steak and make it more delicious, more edible, more, I don't know, like nose to tail eating is obviously something that we do have to address. You know, that whole animal, it has to get used. Like, you can't be wasting any of it. I mean, you know, the Canadian beef industry, we have the lowest greenhouse emissions from our beef industry of any country in the world. So, you know, we are doing a good job, but obviously we are aware that people are more concerned about where their meat comes from, how much it costs, you know, regenerative farming, looking after the land. It's all part of the conversation about how our meat gets on our plate now. Consumers care more about that than they probably ever have.
Cool.
Yeah.
I'm blown away. I'm kind of speechless. You're teaching me all this new stuff. Well, it's not new, but it's new to me. It's just crazy. So what are you doing here? So you're just chopping up steaks? Those are big steaks. Why are they so big?
Well, you know what? Like, I would say that's a pretty, I'm going to wait for you. I would say that's a pretty standard steak. You know, it's a quarter, 3/4 of an inch to an inch, which is a standard butcher's cut steak. Like, if you go into the butcher's shop, this is what we're going to cut for you if you haven't asked for something different. This is pretty standard. I'll tell you how much this one actually
is. Do you want me to guess? Like, see if, like.
Yes, go on. What do you think this one would weigh?
I'm going to say that's 10.
10. I would say, yeah, I'd say it's a bit less.
What's going on here? Come on. Watch how right I am. Hurry.
Well, that's not right. Oh, 16 ounces. That's a big one.
Jeez, we were like way off.
That's the problem. So that is a standard butcher's cut, 3/4 inch.
Really?
So that would have been an 8-ounce steak. And now it's nearly like that's 16 ounces. So,
well, that's a great example about the size of the strips that are getting, right?
100%. And when you think the food, I know that we don't pay attention to them, but the actual guidelines as to how much red meat you are supposed to eat, it's supposed to fit in the palm of your hand, which if you think about it, that baseball steak kind of perfectly does.
Yeah.
So for depends
on your hand size though, right?
It's true. Very true. It's incredibly nutrient dense. It's incredibly good for you to eat, you know, good healthy fats. I do think that meat is never going to go away. You know, we did see kind of a rise in the fake meats and the lab grown things, and I think they won't go away. I do believe that. Yeah. But I think if you care, you know, like the guidelines that Michael Pollan said, you know, you should eat real food, mostly vegetables and not too much. Well, this is real food. And, you know, like if it's done right and we care about where it comes from and demand that it's done well, it is very sustainable. So, but I do think that we are going to see smaller portions and more cost.
Can you try to cut us a 10? A 10 ounce or an 8 ounce?
Yeah,
see how paper thin that is?
I'll try. I'm out of practice. I haven't done this for a while. Okay, so that's a 10 ounce. So you can see the thickness difference there between the one I would normally cut, which is 3/4, and then that's a 10 ounce steak there.
So let's go back to the thinness.
So you're
cooking that way different then, eh?
So.
Holy smokes, is that different?
Yeah, so then if I try and cut an 8, like we're going even thinner. Like
hey, Elyse, you've been in enough kitchens and chefs and stuff like that. Who's cutting the steaks in a kitchen nowadays?
Well, I don't know. Like, I think we are seeing a lot more, like through Nate, like programs like that, where chefs are kind of doing. So there you go. Okay. That is an 8-ounce steak.
It's just a little thin thing.
So, yeah. So there you go. So you've got.
Holy smokes.
This is the 8. They're not that thin. And then that's your 10. And then that's the 16.
So
you can really see what we've got there. Like that's, you know, there's quite a difference there in the thickness, isn't there? Like we're talking that incredibly thin. And one of the challenges is that is also incredibly difficult to cook to the right consistency. If you're asking for your steak medium rare, like that's almost like a minute steak. Like that is going to cook incredibly quickly. So by the time
you
plated it and got it to your customer, it's going to be pushing medium to well, regardless of what you do. So that is the challenges that we're facing, which is why you are seeing more cuts like this one, where it gives you that thickness, it gives you the fat cap, but it's a more consistent steak on a restaurant menu because you can cook it to the right consistency without risking an 8-ounce steak like this.
So why is it so red? It's really red.
Yeah, and you know what? It hasn't had a chance to bloom. So what happens is meat, when it's exposed to oxygen, it starts the oxygenation process starts on the top, and it does something called a bloom. So that bloom is where it goes, that darker color that we've got. Also, this is like there isn't a lot of age on this beef. It is very, very kind of at the beginning of its aging window. So ideally, I would probably age it for longer, whether it would be wet aged in the seal bag or dry aged once it comes out. But it, you know what? It isn't an indication of anything other than how freshly cut it is. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it's.
So I have a question on the dry aging, wet aging, and stuff like this, just because we definitely went to a lot of wet aging, I would say in the last, I was just trained in that space. I have seen a lot of dry aging, though, come more and more back. Is that coming back, or is it becoming a niche? Is people going that way, or is that just am I totally off?
Trendy. Like, I've been a butcher now for 28 years. and I've seen trends come and go, and you see things come along, and you're like, oh, what's this latest fad now? You know, blah, blah, blah. I remember when ostrich was the fad because they were worried about people with heart disease, and they told everyone who was eating steak that they should eat ostrich. And they took one ostrich steak and then came back and said they were still chewing it up for a week later. Didn't eat any more ostrich. Dry aging, obviously, is, again, it's very scientific. So aging meat, basically, is the process. So dry aging is the process of the moisture coming out of the meat and the enzymes in the meat breaking down those protein structures and those connective tissues inside of the meat. So the minimum age window we use is 14 days. It needs 14 days for those enzymes to start breaking down those connective tissues and for it to become tender. The longer it goes, the more condensed the beefy flavor is because you're losing moisture. And the more those enzymes get to work. So like I've seen beef that's kind of aged using the strains of like mold that are used on blue cheeses.
Yeah.
If you have really aged meat, it does have kind of that blue cheese funk about it.
Yeah.
It's bacteria breaking down the meat, basically. The enzymes are breaking down that meat and turning it into a different protein structure, which is more tender. So, you know, do I think we'll push it too far? Maybe, I don't know. Like,
okay, but I've heard that too. Now, recently on a movie I saw, I'm not going to say what it is, but they said that they're like our beef is aged, and it was in a drying age kind of thing. It was just for the movie, but they said after a certain day, it would like make you sick. Is that possible if you went too far?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah.
Really?
You think about the charcuterie world. Yeah. You use nitrites, which is obviously in bacon and obviously in charcuterie. And the nitrite is there to prevent the bacteria, botulism, from growing inside of there. So, you know, there are bacteria out there that are very bad for us. And if they're allowed to form, it's not good. Okay.
Okay.
Well, generally in beef, that doesn't happen because it needs a certain set of conditions. Like it needs the right moisture. It needs the right temperatures.
Oh, okay.
Different things. And we're not adding anything into this beef when we're dry. You know, we're not adding any chemicals in to prevent certain bacteria from growing. But yeah, it is going to make you, it is going to get to a point where if you go over it, it's bad for you. You know, our bodies can only take certain bacteria, and if they take ones that are not good, then we know it's not good. So yeah, there is going to be a limit. Like I personally, if it gets like over 50 days, I'm not a fan. Like again, personal flavor, but I don't really like those very funky cheeses, and that's where it gets for my liking. So that's when I don't like it. So again, it's personal preference, but I think if you are aging your beef for a whole year, then it's a bit of a science experiment. And also it's a costly experiment.
I was going to say it's a very expensive experiment.
No, right? This loin will reduce by 40-50%. Because by the time all the moisture has gone out of it, all of that's gone, then you have to trim off the ends. You're going to have to trim the entire underneath side off. Anything that's exposed on black on the side is inedible. So it has to be covered in fat. That's where you see those tallow, covered loins, where they're trying to minimize the exposed meat, basically.
Yeah.
And also then that's fridge space in your, it's sat in a fridge and it has to have clear air all around it, underneath and around the sides. Can't be set up. It's got to have airflow all around it. You've got to that's got to sit in your fridge. Like it should pay rent. You know what I mean? Like it's in your fridge for an entire year or 50 days or whatever. It's a bit of a, I don't know. Like it's never.
It's not a good idea.
No, but it's cool. I love the use of science to kind of do these things.
Yeah.
I don't know, it's very funky and I love the experimentation around it. But give me a good 21-day age steak, and I am very happy.
Now I have to ask you some questions around this because I'm sure some people have come into this, maybe they have, I hope they haven't. But what if you don't use all your beef? Let's say you cut all these steaks up on the strip.
Yeah.
You cut them all up, you have it there, and you don't go through them as fast as maybe you want. What's some practices that people should be doing after they cut this all up? Let's get into some of that because I want to talk a little bit about that because I think there's where do they store them? How long do you store them? Do you then have to freeze them? Like, what happens? I don't know.
Yeah, like, you can cut this whole loin up, and if you knew you were going to be eating them in a couple of days' time, then there's no problem in just leaving them in the fridge. So you can almost mimic the dry aging process. So I'll show you. I have some in my fridge right now.
Okay. You would have beef in your fridge, a butcher.
Yeah. Of course I have beef in my fridge. It's just on a cooling rack over a tray. So it's kind of started to age more. So it's kind of dry on the outside.
Yeah.
All underneath it and all around the top. So it can breathe all around. So, my volume's just gone up on that one. Hold on a sec. So it's kind of, you can see, that's you can do that. Yeah. So leave it for a few days. But otherwise, you want to freeze it. So butcher paper is my main answer. I would never wrap something in plastic unless you can remove the air from inside.
Okay.
Of the bag.
Okay, stop on that. Because that's, first of all, another thing I learned today. Because we used to wrap them in saran wrap.
Not good. Because you're trapping air. The meat will sweat a little bit. In that cooling process, it's going to sweat a tiny bit. There's some extra moisture in there as well. So you're creating frost on the inside. So you're at risk of freezer burning. And I wouldn't use Ziploc bags either. Ziploc bags are great. You can kind of push all the air out. But then you throw them in the freezer. And once you've kind of shoved everything around, you've got to get a hole in there. And then moisture's going to get in. Frost is going to get in and you are going to freeze and burn everything. So butcher paper all the way is my solution. That is everything that goes in my freezer is in butcher paper. So moisture build up. It protects the meat. It keeps it going longer. Like cut steaks, I don't know, 3 months, ideally. You don't want to go much longer because you're drying them out. The freezer is drying them out in a bad way, not in a dry aging way.
So when people buy frozen steaks, that they have that there's that opportunity that they're not going to be that good because we don't know how long they've been frozen for. It could be dry.
I mean, thaw them out, put them on a tray on a baking, put them on a rack in the baking tray, put them in the fridge, give them a couple of days.
Hot water in a tap?
No, God no. No. So one of the key things when you are buying meat in a vac seal bag, you want to look for one that doesn't have a lot of purge in there. And if something is defrosted in a bad way, like we all know, we've all worked in kitchens, we throw things in their vac seal bags in the sink and keep the temperature in because you sometimes just have to do it. You are going to suck the hemoglobin out of this meat. And you're going to try it out in a bad way. So it's not blood. It's not blood in the bag. Everyone thinks it's blood and it's bleeding. It's not. It's hemoglobin. And hemoglobin is a water-soluble protein that will leach out of here and it will make your meat dry, which is why that resting period after you've cooked it, imagine going outside in Alberta with the wrong clothes on in winter. Your body tenses up like this. So any extreme of temperature, when this steak hits the pan, it's hot. All the juice is sucked to the middle. You rest it because the hemoglobin needs to redistribute back through the steak as it chills out and relaxes. So the hemoglobin can go back through the connective tissues, and then that's when you don't get a puddle of steak juice underneath your steak. It should redistribute back through the steak.
Okay, I'm fascinated. Anyways, I'm blown away. So is there anything else you want to do to the strip loin, Elyse?
Like,
do you want to try to cut a different ounce?
A different, yeah. 8 ounce. Six, eight, and then this was 16.
16. Yeah. So I have seen this. I want to talk more about this baseball thing because I have seen people take a strip and then just cut it right down the middle.
Yeah.
Can they do that? No. Yeah. But they do it like just in the whole muscle. They take that muscle and whack it down. Yeah.
And then to into pieces.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Wouldn't. Okay, so consistency is key. Again, if you are buying a whole loin and you are going to try and cut it, this was my square off piece. So this was the piece I took off the loin to start off with to square the loin up. So can you see how it's thicker at this end?
And yeah.
Okay, this is the classic triangle cut. And unfortunately, this happens quite often. And I'll give you a tip as to how to stop it and explain why it's bad. So basically what people do is when they're cutting a steak, they watch the heel of their hand here because you're staring at this bit of your hand. Don't look at that. Look at the tip of your knife, okay? So your hand is in control of where the knife is here. And I can see I'm going for that nice 3/4 inch here. Nobody watches that end. So they end up with a triangle cut like that.
Okay. I do that all. Now, okay, we get to get back to the knife technique because I need a little knife skill here. Because I typically, my blade will go sideways a little bit.
Okay.
So then it's like, have you ever cut bread? And then it's like the bread that's really thick at the top. And by the time you get to the bottom of that loaf, if you're cutting bread, it's thin. Now, why?
A lot of the times, sometimes it's because you are not paying attention to this end. And you are too focused on the hilt of your knife here, watching there, not watching the end. And also you are tipping the knife to the side like that. It could be that you're not using a big enough knife. And I know that sounds a bit ridiculous. But like in butchers, we have... I'm going to grab another one.
Get the cleaver. Where's the cleaver?
So,
that knife was huge you had earlier.
So that's not even my biggest one. So this is... I think this is classed as like a scimitar knife. But it's longer, okay? Yeah. Your knife should always be longer than the piece of meat you are cutting. So that's why this one is even longer. Yep. So this is a bigger one. So this is a steak cutting knife. You can't cut this with a short knife like this because it doesn't go all over. So you're going to be sawing at it. So you're just going to have a horrible kind of like cut edge and it's never going to be even. You need a big enough knife to go all the way through your steak. Because if you do cut a triangle, one end is going to be cooked perfectly and one end is going to be overcooked. So that's really important to cut them straight, okay? And then you can use this hand as your guide hand. Obviously, keep your fingers behind and you can
touch. I'm going to go to the other camera here. We're going to get the camera down one. There we go. I got the hands.
Just want to make pushing down nice. And you've got to keep that knife nice and straight. Like if you're tilting your knife even sideways, you're going to make funny cuts like that. But you can see like a nice, you shouldn't have any saw marks on there. It should be nice and straight all the way across, like perfectly.
Yeah.
The other, like so.
Now, I noticed you cut the end off on some of those. Is that normal, that end part there?
My general rule of thumb is if the fat is thicker than your little finger, it's not going to be a great eating experience. So you just want to take a little bit off here and a tiny bit off there. But those bits of trim there will perfectly go into a burger or any grind like that, no problem. But yeah, it never, don't go thicker than your finger. It's not a good eating experience
if you
go thicker than your finger. But there you go, that's a pretty good looking strip line right there.
It does. They look good on the barbecue.
Yeah, just season it up nicely. Salt. Don't put pepper on before you cook it either. That's a
Okay, wait. No. You just ruined that for me now.
It burns. Okay,
tell me. We're not going to talk about the Great Outdoors TV movie either that you had me correct on that big, the 96er. Yeah. So let's talk. You're telling me after, I'm not going to mention how many years cooking steak, pepper after you cook it?
It burns.
No way.
You are cooking, like barbecue should be hot, you know, get that steak in there, oil your meat, don't oil the grill, obviously, because you'll set it on fire. Salt it, and if you either want to salt it, there's like, it's a 20-minute rule, isn't it? It's either up to 20 minutes before or 2 hours before, because it releases like the sticky. Mm-hmm. Anyway, well, that's more science, we're not going to go there. Pepper burns. If you are not careful, you will burn the pepper onto your steak. So salt it, cook it, and then pepper it afterwards.
Because you know how many I see how many times in a restaurant they'll just they have it on the grill, and then they hit the pepper and salt. It's mixed in the shaker itself, and they hit it with they finish their steaks that way on the grill.
Yeah. You're
saying no.
Yeah.
Game changer. I'm blown away.
Salt is a flavor enhancer. You're enhancing the flavor. Pepper is it's a spice. It's a seasoning. Like it. Just put it on after. You'll get a nice, fresh, peppery flavor then without the burnt pepper on there.
There you go. You are a ninja. I told you you're a ninja. Protein ninja. Jeez, this is crazy. This is crazy. Okay. Well, Elyse, is there anything else you want to touch on today or Do you want me to go over and just sit here?
Everyone lots of meaty things to think about.
Like, I think you have. I really do. I just want to thank you again. This has been outstanding. Thanks, Cargill and Clint over at Cargill for giving us these products to play with and to share this. Elyse, we're going to have you back a bazillion times, by the way, of all the knowledge you have is absolutely incredible in this space. So thank you so much for all the work you put in for today. Oh, and to everyone else, you know what? Elyse, you're also on Team Canada, I believe.
I am. Butchery Team Canada, yeah.
Is there?
It's fancy things.
It's a fancy things right there, right? So anyways, I just want to thank you so much and all the stuff you've done today. And to everyone else, we're back again next Monday. Actually, Monday's a holiday, so no. Back on Tuesday, and we have tons of shows lined up. But Elyse, thank you so much. And to everyone else out there, now you know a lot about strip loins and beef and stuff like that. So thank you so much, Elyse. And to everyone else, have a great rest of your day.
Thank you.
See you later.